I'd like to welcome you today to the Tateuchi Democracy Forum. We are pleased that you all have come to the museum for this program. This coming year, 2017, is a big one for our community. It will represent the 75th anniversary of the signing of Executive Order 9066. It is also the 25th anniversary of the public opening of this museum that occurred in 1992, the same day as the LA riots. Our museum actually had to cancel the opening because of the riots. But it was an interesting time because I think it set this museum on a trajectory to really look at how it could be a healing force within the city of Los Angeles with all the diverse people. So it was kind of a godsend, I think, in some ways. Myself, as well as a few volunteers I see here today, have been working here since that time. Sharing the Japanese American experience to tens of thousands of visitors annually. Our hopes to create a better understanding and appreciation of America's cultural diversity, as well as provide a greater awareness of the wartime injustices that occurred to more than 120,000 Japanese Americans so that it might not ever occur again to anyone. It's also important to note at this time that this museum, more than 80% of our operating budget is private and comes from museum members and donors such as yourself. And for that, we are eternally grateful for your contributions and support for the past 25 years. When I first started working here, I didn't know if this museum would last for 25 years, but looking at this room, I think we're thriving and we appreciate your presence here. Yes. This is truly a museum that was founded and sustained by the Japanese American community. So we invite you to stay in touch and be a part of the many exciting programs we have planned for this banner year, including our annual dinner, as well as our 75th anniversary exhibition, which is called Instructions to All Persons. Today's program is part of the Tateuchi Public Program Series that is supported by a partnership between the Atsuhiko and Ina Goodwin Tateuchi Foundation and the Japanese American National Museum. Together, we present programs that explore the connections between Japan and the United States in the context of politics, art, music, and culture. The program series is created annually with the objective of enhancing understanding between the two countries. Today, we are pleased to present Memories of Five Nisei. Five second-generation Japanese Americans will share significant memories of their lives with a focus on the World War II camp experience. These speakers will also compare their camp experiences with the present-day detention centers in Texas for Central American refugees. Lead presenter Sam Mihara is a former executive at the Boeing Company and a nationally recognized speaker on the topic of the World War II incarceration of Japanese Americans. His most recent work is a study of the immigrant detention facilities in Texas. He was also recently just invited by Harvard Law School to speak in November. Yes. Dr. Takashi Hoshizaki is a retired biologist who resisted the draft while he was in camp and was subsequently sent to federal prison for 3 years. After his rights were restored, he joined the military and served in the Korean War to prove his loyalty to the U.S. Toshi Ito is the wife of James Ito, the leader of the agricultural team at Heart Mountain that developed the farms and the produce and that produced food for all camp residents. Toshi's father committed suicide as a direct result of racist treatment following World War II. Willie Ito is an award-winning Disney animation artist celebrated for his work on The Lady and the Tramp. He is also a well-known spokesperson for the Topaz prison camp for Nikkei, where he was incarcerated. Shig Yabu is the noted author of Hello Maggie, an illustrated book that tells the story of a magpie bird that he raised as a pet in camp. Yabu is now an executive in the Boys Club of America. So with that, please help me give a warm welcome to our organizer and lead presenter, Sam Mihara.
Thank you very much, I appreciate that. For a long time, I was looking for the right first sentence in this presentation. It's always a tough problem to find the right first sentence. I turned on the TV this morning, and they're having the dedication of the National African American Museum in Washington. And on comes President George W. Bush. And his first sentence struck me. Let me read it to you. A great nation does not hide history. A great nation does not hide history. I said, that's a perfect entrance. He just read my first sentence. Because I'm not going to hide the history. My purpose is to tell you about all the things that really happened. A lot of it's not written up in books, but I think it'd be helpful because people tend to remember things that were hidden and all of a sudden revealed. And you're going to hear that today with the five speakers. The way to start this program is to start way back before our parents and grandparents immigrated. And that way is to show the first illustration. This is our cartoon from the media back in 1899, 200 years ago. And the image is captioned, "The Yellow Terror Threatens White Women." And here's this armed Asian standing over the slain white woman. And that went out among a lot of people, and the media started spreading this word. And that wasn't the start of it. Pearl Harbor came on, and it got worse. Right after December the 7th, we started seeing all kinds of media attention. For example, this cartoon here, this Asian Japanese soldier with a weapon, and this German Nazi soldier with his weapon, over the continental U.S., and it's captioned, "Our homes are in danger now." So the image is being spread. The enemy is amongst us. This went out in the media at that time. The worst one of all is this one here. It's a cartoon showing a stream of Japanese starting from the state of Washington, going through Oregon, picking up steam, and now we're getting a huge army of Japanese all coming in line to pick up their boxes of nitroglycerin, TNT, and getting a signal from a spotter on top of the roof. He's going to hand it out, and all these Japanese locals are going to get the TNT and go out and conduct sabotage and ruin all the defense installations. This was drawn by no less than Dr. Seuss, the children's doctor. Amazing. But that's the kind of publicity that was going on. I was in San Francisco, and I'll never forget. In January, this newspaper headline came out, "Ouster, getting rid of people of Japanese ancestry is very near." This billboard, done by a famous company called Foster and Kleiser, a very big advertising company in San Francisco, California. This is one block from my house on Sutter Street, Sutter and Laguna, one block away, with a sign, "Bye bye, Japs." I mean, how more insulting can that be? But that's the kind of attitude that the people of California had at that time. There was a photographer, very famous photographer during the early 30s, Dorothea Lang. She became famous for this particular photograph. This is a photograph of a migrant worker, a mother. A picture was taken in a place called Nipomo, California, which is a agricultural section east of San Luis Obispo. And she became famous because of the style that she had the ability to get photographs that shows the people's emotions. You can tell this family's in deep trouble. In fact, this lady, at that time, during the Great Depression, had to sell the tires off of her car to get food on the table. That's the conditions at that time. And Dorothy knew that, and she caught this family at that particular time. That became an award-winning photograph. So the government hired Dorothy to come to San Francisco and start taking pictures of the Japanese people in the process of our moving. And they told Dorothy, "Only take nice pictures. Don't take anything that looks bad for the government." And they did not know. Dorothy does not take orders. Thank God she was able to have the skill to take pictures that are somewhat embarrassing for the government. And I'll show you some of these in a moment. Here's the first one. This is a grammar school about a block away from our Japantown. And these are several friends of mine. And in the middle especially is a guy named Hisashi Kobayashi with a striped t-shirt. We called him Kobe Kobayashi, and he turned out to be a pretty good fellow. I'll talk about him a little bit later. Another famous picture that she took, probably the most famous of all, is this one here. The 8-year-old schoolgirls lined up and doing their Pledge of Allegiance in the morning. And again, look at the faces. You can tell that each of these kids have this, you know, tremendous desire to show their allegiance to the United States. You cannot get 8-year-old actresses to do that again. But Dorothea Lange had that skill to snap that at the right time, and that became famous. And I'll talk more about that picture in a moment. And of course, everyone here knows a particular phrase in the Pledge of Allegiance, which is with liberty and justice for all. And we were all denied liberty, we were all denied justice at the time of our removal. Roosevelt made a decision based upon the recommendation of his staff to put out this executive order. Now, what's commonly misunderstood is the executive order itself does not specify Japanese to be removed. It simply gave the authority to move to the local military types. So all he did was saying, oh, I'm giving the authority to move people to the military people in each of the districts. And here are the districts in the United States. In the eastern section, there was a Lieutenant General Hugh Drum. And in his district, there were German Americans and there were Italian Americans. And he had the choice, shall he remove those people because of the threat on the Atlantic side. He decided not to remove Germans and Italians. On the other hand, and one reason being, by the way, the industry in the East Coast had hired many Germans and Italians, and the industry complained to the military commander, don't do that, because our business will be ruined. Similarly, there was a general in Hawaii named General Emmons, Lieutenant General Emmons. He had to make a decision. What do we do about the Japanese in Hawaii? And he made a similar decision. If I remove all the Japanese in Hawaii, I mean, 40% of the workers in the pineapple industry are Japanese. It'll be ruined. So the pineapple industry people said, don't do that. It's bad for business. And so he decided not to do that. But on the West Coast, we have this General John DeWitt. DeWitt's history clearly showed that he was a racist. He had made statements and published statements to the effect that he said a Jap is always a Jap, doesn't matter what generation, and therefore they must all go. By definition, a 1/16th drop of blood, 1/16th blood, if your background is Japanese, you're out. And that's a decision he made. So he's the one who actually put out the order that it shall be the Japanese to be removed. We had these signs going up in front of our homes in San Francisco and elsewhere giving instructions on when to leave, where to leave, what bus to catch. There will be a curfew. You have to stay in your homes between 8 o'clock at night, 6 in the morning. And other rules, like you cannot go outside a certain boundary. They had certain streets identified as boundaries, and we couldn't leave that. And so we had to stay within the district. And there were several other similar type rules. This picture is another one taken by Dorothea Lange. It shows then the heads of the household lining up in front of a Japanese language school in San Francisco, which was taken over by the government and turned into a registration office. This is a registration office for Japanese to come and register who's who in the family. That's how they got the list of people who are going to go into which different camp. And this photograph is an example of one the government hated. It shows an armed guard with a weapon forcing people to take steps. And when they saw the pictures that Dorothea Lange showed them, they held all of these photographs in a vault in UC Berkeley, at Bancroft Library, and they kept it there for a long time, never to be seen, until they were finally released. But that's how accurate a photographer she was to be able to take these important sensitive pictures. The group of fellows also taken by Dorothea Lange, the fellow in the middle, goes by the name of Katsutoshi Ito. That's his first name. The father gave him this difficult to pronounce name. And the father realized that it was a mistake because his friends are going to have trouble in pronouncing Katsutoshi. So he renamed him Willie. And Willie is has been a good family friend for a long time. And Willie has a fantastic memory of what happened in those days, especially right after World War II. So I've asked Willie to come up and give a real short summary of what he remembers about those difficult times, the days before we went to camp. So Willie, if you will, do your thing.
Hello.
Is that okay?
Well, basically, when I was 5 years old, I was sitting in our neighborhood movie theater, and on the big screen, in living Technicolor, seven little men marched across the scene singing, "Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go." And I says, "Wow, I want to be that." No, not one of the seven dwarfs, but an animated cartoonist. After the movie, we went to our local F.W. Woolworth Five and Dime store, and I got my first souvenir from Snow White. I rushed home, put this on my dresser, and I would see Dopey when I went to bed at night. And the first thing when I woke up in the morning. The Sunday that I recall, it was the infamous December 7th. We had gone on a picnic down to Santa Cruz, and when we came back, MPs stopped us at the city limits. We couldn't go beyond unless we had proper ID. My uncle, who was a teenager at that time, was driving, and I was with my aunt-to-be. She was still a girlfriend of my uncle. As we got into the city, every corner had newsboys singing, shouting, "Extra, extra, it's war, extra, extra." I had never heard that word war before. And I never knew the meaning of the word war, but I soon found out. When we got home, my mother was going crazy because there was no way for her to reach us down in Santa Cruz. Remember, these were days before cell phones. My family was all gathered at the house, and why would Japan do such a thing was a big question of the day, and what the consequences will be for us Japanese Americans. The next day was business as usual. I went to school, and one of my classmates would just break out in tears. And I found out later that he was a son of a Buddhist minister who was arrested right on the pulpit as he was giving his Sunday service. The FBI just stormed into the church and took him away. And he ended up at Mesalu, Montana, which is a federal prison, along with many other of our civic leaders in Japantown. Of course, I came home one day. Now I'm beginning to hear more and more about the meaning of the word war. I came home, and sitting very passively on the couch with my mother and father. And in the house were two great big FBI agents wearing fedora caps in raincoats, and they were rifling through all of our personal belongings, looking for contrabands. Well, one of the things that they absconded with was my father's family heirloom, a katana sword that he brought back from Hiroshima. We never saw that sword again. Well, I panicked. I ran upstairs to the bedroom, thinking that they may have absconded with my dopey bag. It was still there. Well, the word came out that we're going to have to relocate to a camp. And we were only allowed to take what we could carry with two hands. So needless to say, I was unable to take my little dopey bank. But we went to our camp, which was Tamfaran, similar to Santa Anita here. It was a horse racing track, but it was all barbed wire, and they had armed sentries constantly checking the camp out. We had strict curfews and roll calls every night. But about 3 months later, our permanent camp inland was now ready for occupancy. So we again packed up and got on trains, went overnight, and when we arrived at this little town of Delta, right in the middle of the Utah desert, it looked like a scenery right out of a John Wayne Western. We got off the train, got on buses and trucks, and we were taken into our camp 60 miles inland. It was desolate. It was dusty. It was hot. Fine alkaline dust, which was like talcum powder, was blowing around. My grandfather had on his Sunday best, a fedora, a dark fedora cap, and a dark overcoat. It was all white with all that alkaline dust blowing around. We figured, well, maybe we go indoors and we would be, you know, kind of get out of all that dust and whatever. Indoors was stifling hot, so my mother opened up the window and the door for cross ventilation. Didn't help. The dust kept blowing in. The duration of the time that I was in camp, I would stay indoors a lot because I love to draw. The drawing material available to us at that time was like expired Sears and Roebuck and Montgomery Ward catalogs. So I would take these catalogs, and on the margins, on the corner, I would make little drawings of characters, very similar to this. And this was my very first foray into the art of animation. So when we, now it was June of 1945, we were allowed to go home. So we packed up and went back to San Francisco. Fortunately for us, we had a home to come back to, because my father, he was Hawaii-born Nisei. My mother was San Francisco born, and he was a little more optimistic about the outcome of the war and all. So he never sold his house or got rid of it. We had a very close Chinese family that stayed in our home. And so it was so nice to get back to our own home. Naturally, I ran upstairs, checked my dresser. There was my little dobie. Years passed. I was getting ready to graduate college, San Francisco City College, and my instructor there says, you know, you should go to Los Angeles and study animation art, because they've got some of the best schools there, which I was a little reluctant to do, because I was a little hesitant about leaving my family, my home, my friends in Japantown. The prospect of coming out to Hollywood in the big white world was a little intimidating, But I was fortunate enough to get a scholarship. So I did come down, attended the Chouinard's Art Institute, and while I was a student, on a whim, I thought, I think I'm going to see if I could get a job at Disney, not thinking it'll ever happen. So I ended up at Disney Studio, and some of the very first scenes that my mentor, who happened to be Iwo Takamoto, now he was an internee at Manzanar. He was a natural. He was the first Japanese American to be hired in a major studio right after the war. And fortunately, he was my mentor. And this is a scene that I worked on with him. So my career, basically, thanks to Iwo Takamoto, lasted 50 years, and I retired from Disney in 1999 as the director of Character Art International, which meant that I traveled to all of our Disney offices around the world, training and mentoring young regional artists. Fortunately, I had a good career. I was very pleased with how my life worked out. But thinking back to a lot of the young Niseis that their education was interrupted, they ended up going into the war, many of them losing their lives. And I certainly hope that incidents like this will never ever happen again. Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. Great job. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And here's that example. All of you remember the movie about Willie's Lady and the Tramp. That's the work that he did, fascinating activity. Okay, so we got ready to go to the camp. Here's an example of another Dorothea Lange photograph. Family, young kids wearing name tags, prisoner number, names, embarrassing. These kids had to live with that memory forever. Another shot, a little youngster carrying the doll. But this one is most important. I find it fascinating. Here's a little boy, 4 years old, being searched by two armed guards and a plainclothes policeman looking for weapons. And his mother's looking on very, very carefully just before that young fellow was put on the bus to be taken to a prison camp. This is one of the better ones that she took. And again, very, very embarrassing for the government. We went to, this group went to Tanforan at first. And then some of the people had to live in terrible conditions. The first people had to live in horse stalls. And when there were not enough horse stalls for everyone, they had to build some shacks right in front. I remember living in one of those shacks right in front of the horse stalls. A tough, tough situation. The day came 33 months later when the trains came and put us all in, these large trains, and now the soldiers are shoulder to shoulder, making sure we don't get away. And we boarded the trains, got on there, stayed on there for 3 days and nights, and not knowing where we were going. And our train in particular went then to Heart Mountain, Wyoming. Here's a map, quickly going through this. On the left, you'll see a lot of dots, that are the assembly centers, typically horse race tracks. In the center of the country are existing federal prisons. These are run by Department of Justice. I knew many friends who went to places like Missoula, Montana, and Lordsburg, New Mexico. But the main camps were the ones that were built just for the Japanese, and that is in the triangles, the one in Heart Mountain, one in Colorado, one in Idaho, one in two in southern Arizona, two way out there in Arkansas, and two on the eastern slopes of California. Where's Heart Mountain in particular? Well, if you have been to Wyoming and you've been to Yellowstone, Yellowstone's here on the left, And 30 miles away is a little town called Cody, Wyoming, named after Buffalo Bill. And it had about maybe 2,000 people in those days. And a little smaller town further up called Powell, Wyoming, maybe about 1,000 people. Heart Mountain is right smack in the middle between the two towns in a place called Heart Mountain. That's the name of the mountain that was there. I was curious as to what did the people of Cody think about us when they first heard we were coming to the area? So I saw this headline, all of a sudden this headline in the Cody Enterprise, 10,000 Japs to be interned here, like downtown Cody, even though it was 15 miles away. The impression that one gets is they're coming to this town, all these people. The town of Powell had a worse headline. 10,000 is a lot of Japanese. Of course, there was only one family, Japanese family, in the entire section of Wyoming at that time. So of course, 10,000 is a lot. There's one fella who remembers those days. His name is Senator Alan Simpson, senior senator from Wyoming. He lived in Cody. He was a Boy Scout, teenager. And I saw an interview of Alan Simpson talking about what he remembered during those days in Cody, what the people of Cody thought when they heard that we were coming. Let's watch this video. You'll be surprised.
So then we were told there were 11,000 people there. Well, there were only two cities larger than that in Wyoming. That was Cheyenne and Casper. Powell was about 2,500, Cody probably 3,500, and so people thought, now if those people escape, we'll all be killed. Well, there were 11,000 of them there, and they're going to break out, and they'll come to town, and we'll be dead.
Isn't that something? 10,000 men, women, seniors, children are going to break out of camp and descend on town of Cody and kill them all. Amazing. That attitude continued on. There was a conference in Salt Lake City where several representatives from each state, the governors of each state, met. And the government tried to explain to them the purpose of the camp, which is simply a housing station to hold people, and they're going to be encouraged to move out of the camps and go back east and no longer stay in your own state. And people like this governor of Wyoming, Nell Smith, made a statement. And by the way, this is in the records, the minutes of the meeting in Salt Lake City. And he made the statement that, if these people escape, they'll be hanging from every pine tree. Imagine a northern governor, a northern state governor in my lifetime promoting lynching, terrible. But that was the condition. And the other state governors had similar kinds of statements. It was awful. So the government said, okay, we yield, we give in. We're going to change the design to a prison. So at the urging of the states, they converted Heart Mountain, all the other camps, into a regular prison with barbed wire fences, guard towers, armed guards, so forth. Not many people know that. They thought the federal government was responsible for the prison conditions. It was not, it was the states, the people from the states who demanded this. Awful situation. And to this day, we don't have an apology from the states yet. The best we've heard is regret, and that's not an apology. So anyway, the camp would continue being built, and the carpenters came in, 2,000 workers built every hour. The camp looked like this. The objective to have a finished camp of 30 blocks, 24 barracks in each block, each barrack having 6 rooms. And typically the end rooms are smallest, holding about 2 or 3 people. The middle ones are the medium size. That's where my family was, 4 people in a room 20 feet by 20 feet. Here's the inside of a typical room. This is a recreation we have at the museum at Heart Mountain, showing wall-to-wall cots. And in the corner, there was a potbelly stove that held a coal and nothing else. Everything else we had to bring in, all of the furnishings and everything else in the room, we had to make it more livable for the 3 years that we were there. Here's a finished camp. The barracks on the left, Heart Mountain's in the middle, and on the right side, the perimeter fence, 5-foot fence. tall guard towers, and there were nine towers surrounding the entire camp. When I got there, all the people had the same situation. We were given two numbers. One is the block number, room number, cell number. That's 1422C. That's my room, and block 1422 barrack number, and room number C or cell C. On the right, this picture here is a summary of all of the important features of this Heart Mountain camp. We had an armed guard on top of the guard tower with a weapon pointing toward the barracks. In the middle, you see the details of the guard tower, which is the floodlights facing in toward the barracks. The right side, you have the signs, which has English and Japanese along the perimeter saying, you know, warning, stop. Do not cross this perimeter or you could get hurt. In fact, there were seven people who were shot and killed at the various camps during World War II by trigger-happy guards. So that's the system they had to call it to make sure we stay within the prison unless we were given permission to move. There's one fellow who has a bright memory. I ran into Shig a long time ago. He was a neighbor of mine in Block 14 and a neighbor of mine in San Francisco. But he remembers the details of what happened in these camps. And Shig, if you now will you please come up to the podium and tell everybody what you remember about what happened while you were a young boy in the camp.
Remember? Holy mackerel. 10 years old. Never had a watch. Now I have a Kmart $12 watch. But we did have one signal. Ding, 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 clang, clang, bong, bong. That meant mess hall. That's the time to eat. That's how we knew what time it was during the day. In the mess hall, the first four tables were isolated just for the teenagers, except my family did not allow me to eat with those guys. And because my parents are so old-fashioned, no disrespect to the elderly, but I could not stand sitting in the barrack with my parents because they were so old-fashioned. And so, for entertainment, we played marbles, chase, rings, fish. And at one time they had barracks underneath, it was on blocks, so the wind came underneath the barrack and people complained. Well, some bright person created a beautiful way to stop it. Put dirt all the way around the barrack. Well, what we did with the dirt, We made trenches and made little holes like a golf course, and we played marbles. And I'm sure a lot of people remember some of those days. My problem was I had holes in my knees. And unfortunately, my last name is Yabu. Yabureta. Yabureta pants. That meant torn pants. And when Sam asked me to wear tie, a nice Sunday clothes. That was not a 10-year-old. This is out of style, but that's okay. And then the cold weather came. We could not play marbles. It was too cold. They had a place where the adults washed their clothes. They had a sink and so forth. But on the opposite side was the recreation area. Well, you know, in the cold weather, we depended on the catalogs. Because us Californians, we did not wear heavy clothing. The one clothing I hated more than anything else, it was really embarrassing. It's called long johns. Yeah, you got buttons on the rear end. Well, I won't discuss it. But the catalogs or the cold weather served another good purpose for us kids. Snowball fights, making snowmen. And one of the things that we enjoyed more than anything else was ice skating. No, it was not an ice skating ring like you find in California. All they had to do is put dirt around, put water in it. Next morning, we had ice. After the catalog was used, well, guess what? The adults used it to start a fire in their potbelly stove. Well, us kids, we got the catalogs. And no disrespect to anybody, but we made little balls. And us little boys, I hope it works. Well,
wrong catalog.
Well, sorry, but it did work. The little ones, you could shoot peas, or you could use peanuts. And we had 60 kids in our elementary school, and the teacher couldn't control 60 of us. We also made little darts with little pins with a matchstick and a tail. The older guys played penny ante, took money from us kids. Thank goodness there's no kids in here. But one of the dumbest games we ever played was we all carried a knife. Inside, there's an electric socket. One person put the blade inside the electric socket, and we all held hands. And the last person got the biggest shock. So we all took turns being on the last person. Yeah, we had a lot of different games. Then we started to play games outside. Capture the flag. Of all things, we played prisoner's base. Well, we were already in a prison, but that was fun. The catalogs allowed us to get sporting equipment. So we had a guy by the name of Flyer Tabata Yoshinoa. They organized a baseball game. If we didn't have enough players, we played pickup ball. And at that time, there was too many gangs formed. And I should say this very loud, I'll whisper it. Those people in Los Angeles were yogures. I'm from San Francisco. They hated us guys because we were so light-complected and we were dressed so nice. But anyway, the intramural conquered some of that. We joined the Boy Scouts. They had arts and crafts. In the Boy Scouts, there was a place called Dry Riverbed. All we had to do was boil hot water in a gallon can. I never heard of Lipton soup. Yeah, we tasted that, and that was so good. Better than the mess hall. We had Kool-Aid with our dirty hands. We put the Kool-Aid on our palm of our hand, and we all had red mouth, green, purple. But you know, one of the things that we really enjoyed was pets. The first pet we thought we had was Akira Yoshimura and I found a little hole, and out came a little bug. We thought, wow, we got our first pet. Except it tried to keep stinging us with their tail. We found out later it was a scorpion. We had ticks, and the reason why we know that because they gave us tick shot to prevent us to get Rocky Mountain fever and other inoculations. And then we went we had a fellow by the name of Ken Sewell. He was the best slingshot shooter in camp. He taught us how to make slingshot. At the beginning, they allowed us to go out of the barbed wire fence with a group leader, walking not too far away. But it didn't take very long. Somebody said, do you know, less than a mile away, there's a river called Shoshone River. We didn't care about the military police. With our legs, with our arms, we pried open the barbed wire, not 10, not 20, not 100. Many, many people went out to the Shoshone River. Now, some of the older teenagers that were brave swam in that cold, icy water with that swift current. But we found a little pond that the water from the Shoshone River went in. It was great. We could swim at least 25 feet or less until somebody said, hey, there's a green snake. Well, at least it's not poisonous. But the guy in the very end said, it's got rattlers on the end. Well, that was the last time we went swimming in that pond. One boy, a Boy Scout, drowned in the canal. So the farmers dug a hole, big hole. So the irrigation ditch water went into the swimming hole, and it went out. During the summer, we spent a lot of hours swimming. We had a lot of campfires. So we would go to the mess hall, take out the mud, we begged for potato, covered it, put it in, under the fire, and when we left, we peeled off the mud and ate that potato. Was it good? And then the guys from Hawaii, they had ukuleles, you know, Manuele Boy, Hawaiian War Chants, and some of the other hip parade songs. And I remember when we used to have little dates, I was only 11, we would hold hands and we would sing, don't sit under the apple tree with anybody else but me. Heck, we didn't have an apple tree in the whole camp. Somebody's supposed to faint when I have 5 minutes is up. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I want to tell you a little else about this camp. We had toilets, 18 toilets in a row, serving 600 people in a half a block, and no partitions on the men's side. Not sure what the women's side looked like, but this is what it looked like on our side. It was awful. We had bathtubs, which we made because they didn't have any bathtubs. We had to make it out of pickle barrels, and that helped out to keep us well soaked. And the winters were miserable. It got down to minus 28 degrees that first winter in Heart Mountain, and that was really, really bad. But there's another part of life at Heart Mountain and all the other camps which is very important, which is the fact that a lot of Japanese Americans volunteered to go to the military, and it started in Hawaii. There was a large number of people, the volunteers from Hawaii, joined the military, and when they needed more people, they came to the camps and asked for volunteers from the camps. And there were a number of people from Heart Mountain. There were some 800 people who volunteered from camp. And when that wasn't enough, then the draft came to Heart Mountain. So the military then instituted a draft system. Well, that created a problem for about 10% of the people at Heart Mountain. And as a result, some people decided to resist going, about 10%. And among the things that happened was a trial in Cheyenne, Wyoming, of people who were found not obeying the rules for registering the draft and so forth. And one of them in this photograph, way in the back right here, is a young man at the time. His name is Dr. Takashi Hoshizaki. And fortunately, and I call him Tak. Tak is very graciously decided to come and explain to you what he remembers from those days. So, Tech, would you please come on up and share your thoughts?
I was 16 years old when we ended up in the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds at Pomona. I was a naive kid, completely ignorant of what was really happening. Listening to the older Niseis, I heard JACL betrayed us. Well, that was the Japanese American Citizens League. And then they also heard we should have protested and we should have resisted. What's going on, I thought. Listening more, I soon realized that things were terribly wrong. Thinking on what I was hearing and remembering what went on in my neighborhood, I wrote a bitter complaining letter to my homeroom teacher at Belmont High School saying that removing us and putting us into an assembly center was unfair, unjust, and wrong. She wrote back saying she was sorry that I was upset about what had happened to me. I guess unknowingly, this is the start of my protest about our removal and detention behind barbed wire. From Pomona, we were sent to Heart Mountain, Wyoming. After a year, the authorities sent out questionnaires to determine our loyalty, and the draft of men from the concentration camp started. In response to the draft, there was a group of older men at Heart Mountain trying to contest the draft. Frank Emmy, Guntaro Kubota, and others were of this group. They were seeking some way to contest the draft. In the meanwhile, and not surprisingly, individuals and groups were working to get us out of the concentration camp, hopefully by bringing lawsuits against the U.S. government. The Fair Play Committee of Kiyoshi Okamoto was one of these. Frank Emmy and Kiyoshi Okamoto, having similar goals, joined forces. A new, stronger Fair Play Committee was then formed to contest the drafting of young men out of the concentration camps. The new Fair Play Committee formulated a stand. One, we would gladly serve if, one, our civil rights were returned, two, our families were released from camp, and the families could return home. By May of 1944, a total of 63, which you saw on that picture, resisted, and we were then sentenced to 3 years in the federal penitentiary. 33, the younger ones like me, were sent to McNeil Island Federal Penitentiary, located just south of Seattle, Washington. After about a month in the maximum security prison, we were transferred to a minimum security prison, which we called the farm. Living quarters there was like a dorm with no bars, no barbed wire, no searchlights, but to check on us, they had multiple head counts. The prisoners at that time were mostly draft resistors, conscientious objectors, Quakers, Jehovah's Witnesses, and then the 33 of us. Now, prisoners were paroled after serving one-third of their sentence. A year had gone by. Why no parole for us? 2 years went by. Still, no parole for us. We were released after serving 2 years, and this was a year after the war had ended. And the reason for no parole? Well, one of our group, George Ozawa, was working in the warden's office and found two letters. One was from Dylan Myers, the director of the concentration camps. Dylan Myers' letter was addressed to the director of the federal prisons, James Bennett. In that letter, Myers requested that the resistors not be given paroles in the 1 year time, since that would be just a tap on the wrist when compared to the military service. And if we were returned to the concentration camps, it may present a problem, recruiting problem for the Army. Bennett sent the letters to all the wardens to consider Meyer's request. George Nozawa copied and then smuggled those letters out, and I have copies of those in my file. So, no parole for us. But better yet, how about a pardon? President Harry Truman in December of 1944 pardoned all the draft resistors. Our criminal records were officially wiped off the books. We were no longer ex-cons. Our civil rights were returned. However, my story doesn't end here. There's a little more. I was finishing up my master's degree at UCLA when I received my second draft notice. Now, out of the 63 Heart Mountain resistors, six of us were still young enough to serve during the Korean conflict. And now, looking back, we had our civil rights returned, our families were now out of the concentration camps, and six of us gladly served. And as someone said, we did double duty. First, served 2 years as resistors of conscience in the federal penitentiary, and second, served in the armed forces, in my case, 2 years as a medic. Now, in closing, I would like to say that we are now living in the very perilous times. And my foremost hope is that in the future, no one else, no other group will ever have to go through what we experienced. And finally, to all of you for attending and listening to me, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Tech. Very well done. Thank you. Toward the end of our stay at Heart Mountain, the government decided to let us out a few at a time. But we got a little pass. It says, day pass. You're allowed to go into Cody and look around, shop, but you must be back by sunset. So very, very clear instructions. So I remember going into the town of Cody down Sheridan Avenue and walking up and down Sheridan Avenue, looking inside the stores. And all of a sudden, I see this kind of a sign, no Japs, among the stores. Now, this isn't every store, like every third store, but it was these awful signs that clearly sent a message that people here hate us. They didn't want us here, and they don't want us inside their stores. So that left a real bitter feeling among all of us. But to make it accurate, that wasn't everybody's view, because in the wintertime, at Christmas time, we got Christmas gifts. There were some 5,000 Christmas gifts that were sent in to Heart Mountain and all the other camps similarly from the local people. And so the majority, I would suggest, is really more sympathetic. And that was a very, very nice touch. In the end, there was a heroic lawyer, a young attorney in San Francisco, named James Purcell, a really bright fellow. He figured out how to get us out. And that is, he looked at the three cases. You know, everybody knows about Korematsu, Hirabayashi, and Yasui cases. The problem in those three cases is they all admitted that they violated the rules. You know, the curfew rules, the crossing the boundaries, and not registering and so forth. It was a done deal in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court says, no, you're guilty of what you admitted is bad. But Purcell had another view. He said, if I found somebody in the camps, one person who is a perfect model citizen, and he found her in the name of this lady, Mitsue Endo, never been to Japan, had no association with Japanese groups. In fact, she worked for the state of California in a DMV department. And so he talked her into being a defendant and claiming that she should not belong in a camp being a loyal U.S. citizen. And he took it to the Supreme Court. And finally, after 3 years, it was a unanimous decision. Everybody agreed. You should not be held. At the same time, let everybody go. And that's the way that we got out of camp. This one case, due to this one person, this young lawyer. So the camp started to come apart, and they took the barracks and they sold it off for $1 a piece, spread it out among the countryside in Wyoming and southern Montana. We got back home, the life was still very, very bad. You know, we were greeted by these kinds of signs, people saying that, you know, we're no longer welcome here at home, and to keep moving on. We looked at our stored goods. These are the stored things that we could not take with us. And I remember our family goods were either stolen or it was in ruins. And so we really lost quite of material. There's another family that I wanted to mention. This couple met at Heart Mountain, James Ito and his wife Toshi. And James was the head of the farm operations. That's the way we got to eat decent food after about a year, because of his skills as a farm administrator. And Toshi was his wife. Well, Toshi remembers because after they came out of camp, it was a difficult time for them. In fact, her father had difficulty finding a job. And in this video made by David Ono and Jeff McIntyre, she explains what happened. Let's watch this.
Not being able to provide for his family left him desperate.
And so he committed suicide. He finally figured out that if he committed suicide, my mother and I would be taken care of because she would get the money from the insurance.
It happened when Toshi was a newlywed, on her honeymoon. She received a call that her father was sick and she needed to come home. She remembers stepping off that train and being told what really happened.
I just started to cry, and I went to my mother and I hugged her and I said, I'm so sorry, you know. And then when I got home, I went to his bed, and on the side he slept, and I just lay there and I cried, and I could smell his hair tonic that he wore, and I never cried so much in my life.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Toshi Ito.
My parents knew they had a home to go back to, so they were among the first few who went back to Los Angeles, which had been in the exclusion zone. The war was not over yet and would not be over for another 8 months. Therefore, the hatred toward the Japanese was the enemy was very strong when they returned. Winter in the snow and ice and winds was a miserable time in Wyoming. The first winter, it got down to 28 degrees below zero. And you had to bundle up in a coat and boots every time you had to go to the latrine to take a shower, or three times a day to the mess hall. I'm sure this is what my parents wanted to escape. My parents were grateful to their mentor, Mrs. Lily Douglas, for taking them in. When they returned to their home, the tenants would move out. And they are grateful to the Douglases also to get the sheriff to evict our tenants. My parents finally moved in, but they vandalized some of our furniture before they left and took some precious things. I met Jim Ito when he was in charge of administering leaves from the camp. Marie Yamashita and I were the first two to receive educational leave passes. And so Jim was so happy that he was successful in getting some students to leave the camp. He came down to the camp gate to see us board a bus to leave. That's when I wore a dress and high-heeled shoes and my one and only nylon stockings. You know, nylon went into the war effort and they weren't available for public civilians' consumption. Jim took a second look at me, and he was smitten. The first summer vacation from National College, I went back to Harp Mountain. My parents couldn't afford to keep me 3 months in the dormitory there at the college. That's when Jim came by to ask me about my college life. And then he started to date me with movies. We had a movie theater in camp and dances. And his agricultural department had a barbecue picnic. And I got to ride in his truck. You know, when you're in camp and have days and days go by, you never ride a car or a truck. It's something. Yeah. Jim had a BS degree in agronomy from UC Berkeley, so he was the first agriculture superintendent assistant to Glenn Hartman of the camp. And he had to map out where the fields would be, and he also had to clear the land of sagebrush and weeds and rocks. Oh, it was a tough job. He told me he took What is the machine that the farmers use? Tractor. He had two tractors and pulled a chain between the two tractors and cleared the land of sagebrush and rocks and so forth. Anyway, it was a tough job. And he also had to make the hot frames to start these vegetable seeds growing. And fortunately, there was a man who had a seed store in Imperial Valley, and he sold Japanese seeds of eggplants and cucumbers and napa and various Japanese vegetables. And so they were lucky they got to grow those and have them in camp. The food really improved when the fresh vegetables were added. After the farm project was well established, Jim volunteered for the Army and was sent to Fort Snelling in Minnesota to be an interpreter-interrogator. On his first furlough, he came to Kansas City with an engagement ring in his uniform pocket and proposed. When I telegraphed my parents that I was engaged to marry Jim, I thought they would wire back, "Wait until you graduate college." However, they wired back, "We will plan to have your wedding this summer vacation time." So I was married in July 1945. I was on my furlough, I was on my honeymoon. When I received a telegram from my parents at the demise of my father, which you saw on the screen. It took me almost 2 years. It took almost 2 years for the probate, for the my father's will to go through the probate court. Oh, I tell you. It took me 19 and a half years to write my memoirs because I just couldn't do it. At any rate, the will went through the probate court, but it took almost 2 years. And in the meantime, we sold my father's office furniture, his six steel filing cabinets, his typewriter, adding machine, they had them in those days, and his Buick. And they all sold very well because all steel items were not manufactured for civilians during the war. And I had an army wife stipend, so I managed to enroll at Chapman College and graduate. I think the worst part of our incarceration was coming back, getting out, because most people had lost their homes or their jobs or were underpaid. We had a hard time. We have spoken about our incarceration, so it will not be forgotten. Forced removal and imprisonment should never happen again without due process of the law. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Toshi. We all appreciate that. Thank you very much. We were not happy after all of that because we felt, no, literally, we were screwed. The government really did it to us. And so we all insisted on an apology. And it took a long time by a bunch of experts. And the compensation had to be there because we wanted not only an apology, but we wanted some reasonable compensation for the damages that we had. And that took a long time. And there was a lot of people put in a lot of effort. But there was one exhibit in Washington, D.C. at the Smithsonian. It featured at the outside this poster of Dorothy Lange's poster girl and the preamble to the Constitution next to it. But inside, there were photographs of the U.S. GIs who went overseas and sacrificed everything, including their lives, in support of the U.S. Country. And at the same time, inside there were photographs of families, their own families who were caught in the prison, like this one here. This is a family of James, Kaz Masuda, the fellow in the uniform there in the middle. The Masuda family are neighbors of mine in Huntington Beach. They're in the next town. But their whole family, elderly and the kids and all, were wrapped up in this one camp. So he came and visited them. Right after the shot was taken, he was sent overseas and he died in action in Italy. And that photograph was sent to the White House as a reminder of the kind of suffering that our families went through. So as a result, President Reagan has signed the bill that gave us the formal apology. And immediately after that, I received a letter along with the others who were still living, the letter saying very clearly that we apologize, a sincere apology from the President George or the President H.W. Bush. Several of us went on to school after that. I went to Berkeley, I went to UCLA Graduate School, worked for 42 years with a Boeing company, helped develop rockets that worked out very well, enjoyed a terrific career. We had the other case of whatever happened to the poster girl, the famous girl in the Dorothea Lange photographs. Well, she grew up. She looks a little different, but not too much different. On the left is a near recent picture. This was at a display at the Getty Museum. The eyes and the nose are still kind of the same. And she grew up, and she changed both her names. Her first name became Helene. The last name became Mrs. Mihara. We've been married for 60 years. I went to Cody, Wyoming, and I said, "What's going on with the people in town?" When we opened the great museum that we had at Heart Mountain, that was 5 years ago, and I looked in the windows, and every window had this sign: "Welcome, Japanese Americans." What a contrast. The people of Cody today are totally different than the people of Cody in 1942. But the bottom line is, why these camps? Why did they exist? Well, I already talked about it. Remember, I talked about the prejudice, the racial prejudice, the hysteria, the media causing the problem. Some of our leaders who failed us and passed rules like the executive order 9066. But I also want to point out that some people today think that imprisonment without due process is a good thing. There are still people who feel that way. And whenever I hear about that, I simply say, hey, look, remember this photograph. The people on the right may not be Japanese. It may have been Germans or it may have been Italians. Today it might be Middle Easterners or Muslims or Latinos. It could be you. And this could be your son trying to get out of the camp, straddling a barbed wire fence with a guard and a long-range weapon pointing toward him. So I say very, very simply, whenever you hear about these things, proposing new camps, remember, never again to anyone, not at all. Thank you very much. Thank you. Before we begin the Q&A, I wanted to quickly, I promised you a quick snapshot. These are some of the people who helped put this together. A quick snapshot of what happened in Texas today. These are camps that's going on right now as we speak. There are thousands of mothers and children from Latin America. And what the government does is take these immigrants, these undocumented immigrants, they segregate them out in terms of mothers and children, like they're shown in this photograph. They take the mothers and children and put them into prisons. Here's one, there are two of them in Texas. They hold a lot of people, 2,000 in one camp, 500 in the other. And I went down and looked at it, and I said, what is going on? And here's what I saw. These are prison camps with fences twice the height of Heart Mountain. They're 10 feet tall. There are cameras at the top and doing surveillance to make sure no one escapes. Inside, there is a regiment system of all of these mothers and children marching to meals, marching to school, and very, very strict. Here's what the living quarters look like. This is their cell, and this is a relatively old picture, about eight mothers and children. I had a report last week that now there are up to 16 people in a cell, and many children sleeping on a concrete floor. I mean, this is a horrendous, horrendous situation. And I've done everything I can to get the word. I've been to Washington to try to talk to people. You know, this has got to stop. And there are steps going on to try to do that. Some of the ladies, mothers who are released on a temporary basis have to wear these leg shackles that are sensors to tell them where they're located at any time. So it's really a sad situation. These prisons are now planned to be growing all over the U.S. And I wanted to simply close out by saying that it can happen, and it is going on today, and should never happen to anyone else. Downstairs, you'll be able to purchase the DVD of the longer program that I prepared, featuring on the inside cover the poster girls, and also you'll see some other products that our speakers have. Shig Yabu and Willie Ito have prepared books, and Willie has prepared a T-shirt. And Shig prepared the video of a new story about Hartman, and in the upper right-hand corner, Toshi's book, autobiography of her life in the camp. So be sure to pick one up if you will. So let's see, Elizabeth, how much time do we have for Q&A?
Very, very interesting program, speakers. Thank you for sharing those memories. I was curious, what was the interaction like, and what were your experiences like with the security? And who was guarding? Was it military that was guarding at all times? And what was that interaction like? Was it hostile, pleasant, something in between?
Let me give you a quick answer, then I'll ask a couple of people to answer that, especially Shig might recall. But anyway, the guards were military guards. At Heart Mountain, to cover 10,000 people, there were only 30 guards. And they rotated around the clock, and their duty was to get on the towers and make sure that no one got out. It was a strange relationship between the people in the camp and the guards. I remember hearing people saying they went up to the guards and tried to talk to them and become friends with them. They had a high school girls club, a chorus, who went up at Christmas time and sang Christmas carols to the guards.
Yeah.
And I had reports that the guards would start flowing tears out of their eyes about the situation that we were held under. But it was a kind of a standoff situation. We never saw a guard in the camp, never saw an armed guard come into the camp. They kept their perimeter distance and we kept ours, and it worked out well. Shig, do you have any other thoughts about what the relationship was between the camp guards and ourselves? Do you have any special memories?
No, they won't talk to us. We're too young.
Anyone else? Toshi, do you remember any relationship with the guards?
No, except what you said about Christmas carols sung to them. Though I have heard that A grandfather, at Manzanar went under the wire to get a ball for his grandson, and he was shot.
Yeah, there have been several cases about that, and it's unfortunate, but that did happen. I should quickly mention, we also had police inside the camp. They had a police force inside the camp maintain order.
Oh, yes.
For example, we had some blocks that had good cooks and other blocks that had bad cooks. And so the police force was required to keep the people in the blocks separated, and they don't go over the line and get the good food and run them out for the people who were living in the blocks. Okay, another question. Okay, here we go. Yes.
Okay. My question is, what are three things that you're grateful for?
What are three things that we are grateful for? That's interesting. Tack, you want to try that one out? What are three things that we are grateful for?
Well, number one, I guess, thinking about what is happening today, that there's a little more recognition of what is beginning to happen. And as I said, we did get our civil rights back. And I think from that that, in fact, I'm wearing the shirt of the Fair Play Committee, and one of the concept of actually having to go through the courts to in order to imprison people. That is so important. Yeah.
Willie, you have any thoughts on that? What are you grateful for about the camp experience?
Well, it certainly gave us quite an experience, especially growing up in a city like San Francisco, where the climate was very mild, and suddenly here you are overnight, and you're in a completely different kind of atmosphere that you're used to. And of course, it was kind of sad because my grandfather passed away in camp, basically of a broken heart, because he came over as an immigrant, made a life, raised a family, and boom, suddenly it was all gone. So that was a really learning process as far as being a kid and seeing that happen.
I have one thought, and that is I'm really grateful for the legal profession. I mean, I talked about James Purcell as an example, but I also mentioned the 50 attorneys who worked very, very hard in trying to get the apology from the government. I mean, that is really a heroic effort, and I hope people in the law profession continue thinking about civil rights as they pursue their own work. And one more question, third question, last one, yes.
Yes, my name is Lawrence Lopez. I'm a retired teacher. I'm 64. My family was deported in 1931. You know, a lot of people don't know that history. So my dad, they were deported to Mexico. He never had a chance to finish school. But when he came out of the service, he went and worked in the flower market, and I used to go with him. His brother was a gardener. A lot of people in the flower market at the time were Japanese ancestry, as well as there's a lot of Japanese gardeners. Knowing that generation, Nisei, a lot of you are well educated, why were there so many people that worked in the flower market, as well as why were there so many gardeners after World War II?
Okay, was there a question in there?
Yeah, the question is why were there so many people working in the flower market after Second World War? There was a lot of Japanese people that worked in
the question is why?
Yeah,
is
why?
Oh, anybody want to take that one? Why?
Well, I know in the case of my uncle, he was a teenager and never had the opportunity to finish schooling. And so when he came out, he just kind of felt he was a little too old to go back to college or whatever, and started in the flower market until he passed away.
Well, may I interject here? But one of the problems that as a minority group, the jobs were not readily available. So you now then moved into a field or into a profession that then is open to you. And I think the flower market was one that was open, and also in the nursery trade. So we go all the way from the plant nurseries all the way into flower production, which was relatively open for our group.
Very good. I do have one thought, and that is when I hired in at the Boeing Company, fortunately, the situation was very, very favorable for Japanese to come in and be hired as an engineer. It wasn't that way before, but it started way, way back, even before World War II, when there were four blacks who went into the White House demanding equal opportunity for employment. And as a result, all of us are enjoying the fact that we're able to get jobs at many, many offices today. And so we owe our thanks to also that part of the population who made the paved the way for us in order to make life a lot more easier for us. Okay, well, thank you very much for joining, and we're going to take some photographs up here in the front. We'll meet you downstairs later. Thank you.